let's talk about the GameStop episode. What would have been done differently? Is there such a thing as a level playing field for retail investors?
A lot of that episode has been misconstrued. I think because there is a very democratic level playing field in the United States for retail investors, and Robinhood was the catalyst for it, but all of the other larger brokers like Fidelity and Schwab and E-Trade and a whole host of others now offer in the United States zero commission trading. You know, that opened up, you know, to this new investor class, call it retail, the opportunity to enter the market in a very, very frictionless manner. Virtu, as a wholesale market maker, is the recipient of a lot of those orders. So it's been very, very good for our business. But because of all of the proliferation of zero commission, you've seen U.S. retail as an investor class gone from around 15% every day of our market to as much as 25%. Right. So that has been a startling increase. And it really happened not because of COVID and the pandemic, but because of zero commissions in November of 2019. It was exacerbated, right? It was like kind of throwing kerosene on an open fire when people were working from home and there was COVID and there wasn't a lot else to do. So people started to trade more and invest more. And so you've seen this become a very, very important asset class. Now this, you know, to your Asian clients and our Asian friends, this may not seem that unusual because in China and in Japan and in Korea, retail is a larger percentage of the marketplace. It's always been important here in the US, but it really has mushroomed as an asset class. And so that's gotten a lot of press. So that's really by way of background. The GameStop situation was very unusual because you had a company that is, I'll call it an old economy company. They literally are storefronts that sit in malls, and people can buy and trade video cartridges. I have a 17-year-old son, and he hasn't been in a mall in 3 years, and he's never bought one of these because you can now do it all digitally, right? So there was a theory that this company was overvalued and was going to go to zero, and so a bunch of hedge funds here in the United States were shorting it. Perfectly legitimate legal activity, and apparently, based on all the evidence I've seen, a bunch of retail investors had a contrary view. And so they decided to buy the stock, and you had what is known as a short squeeze here in the United States. So it was certainly an aberrational event. I would say short squeezes have happened before and will happen again. So that part of the market is not that unusual. The unusual part was that it was really led by this army of retail investors, all of whom were communicating on chat boards and the like. And that led to the situation where Robinhood was just overwhelmed. They were overwhelmed with orders and overwhelmed with inventory. And as you know, and I very well know, because you know we manage risk and we manage capital, when you have a large portfolio that is all going in one direction, right? Everybody's long and there's a lot of volatility in the stock, the clearinghouses, and you run a great clearinghouse, right? They're going to margin. And so the clearinghouse margined Robinhood 100%, if you will, of their inventory, and Robinhood just didn't have the capital to manage that situation. But the system worked because the clearinghouse rules took the risk out of the system by forcing the Robinhood platform to so that their investors couldn't put any more long risk. So the system worked, but unfortunately, I think the communication around it was awful, and it created a lot of conspiracy theories about Citadel and Robinhood, none of which were correct. But it's never a good thing for markets when people don't trust the plumbing of the marketplace and the sanctity of the marketplace. That's really never a good thing for any investor or any market participant. So I was very dismayed to see some of the misinformation and rumors coming out of that. And I think, frankly, the communication could have been a lot better. If I could change one thing, I would change some of the nomenclature. I would never want anyone to say dark pools because it sounds nefarious. I want everyone to call it an alternative trading system or something a little more pithy than that. I would not want the folks to refer to market makers and liquidity providers as HFTs, high frequency traders, because that's got a negative connotation to it. And the last thing is payment for order flow also sounds a lot more nefarious than it really is. All it is a rebate. And exchanges and dark pools and brokers around the world pay rebates all the time to people that provide orders and people that provide liquidity. So that's all payment for order flow is. So I think it creates a lot of, to be serious, it creates a lot of misinformation and then skepticism about the markets. And the folks that I would be most critical of and what I would really want to change is people that call themselves journalists or thought leaders that just mindlessly pick up that rumor and innuendo and start using words like front running or, you know, there's an information advantage that the market makers have. They're taking your client orders. And it's very, I'll use the word disheartening sometimes to hear people that are perceived as kind of industry leaders or thought leaders or quote unquote journalists on TV, you know, talking about marketplaces like there's something surreptitious and the little guy's losing and the big guy's always screwing the little guy. None of that is factually correct. I mean, markets are tough. There are winners and losers, but at the end of the day, they are really transparent, they're really democratic, and they're really fair. So that's one thing, if I could wave my magic wand, in addition to the Panthers winning the Stanley Cup, that's the one thing I would like.